many thanks, and the whole organizing committee to have invited me. The topic is difficult: how to find a research career path in resource-strained countries, balancing novelty and feasibility. I greetings from the Institute of Liver and Biliary Sciences, which is a WHO collaborative center and the only liver university globally. I have nothing to disclose. This shows you the amount of money and the trials which are done in the high income group compared to the number of people living there. And you can see in the low income, the non-industry sponsored trials are much lower compared to the population. So there is a gross inequality in distribution of clinical research, especially in low-income countries, the trials per million inhabitants, or the proportion of industry-sponsored trials. If you look at gastroenterology and hepatology, our field, between 2009 to 18, about 120,000 articles were published, of which almost all were from 20 highest ranking countries. And these included Europe, America, East Asia, and China. India was amongst the only from lower middle income group. You can look at it where the GDP is in trillions, like in US, the number of total articles are quite high, but other countries are far below. If the 20 highest ranking countries, you look at GI and hepatology, we are much lower compared to any other country. When you look at the number of people who are suffering, whether it is hepatitis C or hepatitis B or the combined burden, it is maximum in this part of the world. You look at the NAFLD, all the red is more than 30% of the population has fat. And you can see that this region is dominant. That includes India, maybe Egypt, Turkey, all these countries, 1/3 of the population. So how can we make a difference? This is a very well-known slide. I'll give you my perspectives. First is the problem with funding and money. In 90, the Health Research Development Commission said, strengthen research in the low middle income group countries, as it is the most powerful, cost-effective, sustainable means of advancing health. This has become true in COVID times, but this has not been done. Even today, there is a difference between this, the 90% who live and need and have little money as compared to the wealthy nations. So we need political will, not possible. Innovative schemes in taxation, somewhat possible, like sugar tax, alcohol tax, but not easy. But I think there is a huge role of international development agencies. When we are crossing boundaries, when we are saying wave off the patents, why can't international agencies and big pharma go and get to the places where there is most population living? There are some best practices, structured operational research and training initiative, SORT, which has done some work. And you can see that the output is that under SORT IT, large number of countries, there has been a capacity. At least you can prepare researchers, whether they can do there or collectively with other countries. SORT is a success story. AASLD, and now EASL also has emerging liver scholars program. This must be given to a larger number. Here it should be 10 for AASLD or EASL, 90 for others. ILBS also has a huge initiative, Institute for Liver and Biliary Sciences. We offer a year-long telehepatology certified academic training program for both faculty and residents. And we gave special programs for 3 months to 12 months in HVPG measurement and also advanced hepatology, transplant hepatology. Over last maybe 1 year, we have covered 120 medical colleges and trained more than 700 doctors across India. Let me come to now something more about mentors. What we as clinicians in the underdeveloped or low income groups learn is the patient management. We do not learn that much to look at how a research question can be developed. I think our first job should be as a mentor to learn ourselves and also teach students different way of looking at the same thing, Mona Lisa, different. And this can be done by developing leaderships, collective skills, supporting mentors, and when mentoring is not available, then partnerships and collaborations. These are easier said than done. Not even in our countries or developing countries where collaboration is the bottom of the pit. I have some suggestions. Students must be in today's environment. Everything is e-conference. Please encourage them, even encourage for free participation in conferences. If there is a need for some small fund, try a waiver. Give mentors an incentive so that they can join. So today's world, I think, is where research in resource-restrained countries is possible. And tell them learning by doing opportunities. APASL Asian Pacific, we are running series of courses where how I do it is being done. Well, try and provide them some funds in your institution for free tests. See that the consent forms are dynamic. Don't follow the very strict sponsor trial. Try and make some simple consent forms and make them for multiple trials if possible and ethics approves. The question commonly is by the clinician in the resource-strained countries is, where is the time? Tell them, don't you have time for your kids? Students are your own kids and you yourself have an appetite. So find time. And you have to teach research methodology both to mentors and the student. Because excellence is like a fluid. If you are excellent, wherever you live, whichever university you are, you will give a shape. To me, research is a religion in medicine. Please teach your student that you have to be religious. Teach them and learn yourself to ask a good research question. I'm not going into details, but just take an example or two. I have no particular talent. I'm merely inquisitive. Tell them, any student who can make 20 questions in a day, raise, is brighter than the teacher. I had a Fulbright and my mentor only asked me this thing. This was mid-80s. If you can generate a question, you know some of these can be answered. So the power of observation is to be taught everything what you do not understand, question. Let's start with the example. What is the cause or site of high portal pressure in non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis? In cirrhosis, we know it is the liver which becomes hardened, sinusoids, and the fibrotic bands. But in non-cirrhotic, what is the site? So this study I did several years ago, where we found what is the pressure in the spleen, what is the pressure in the portal vein, what is the pressure in the liver, what is the pressure in the varices and transjugular, what is the post-sinusoidal or wedge pressure. We found the wedge pressure, which normally in cirrhosis, let's say it is 20, will correlate with the spleen pressure. The spleen pressure and the wedge pressure are same in cirrhosis. But in non-cirrhotic, Suppose you have a spleen pressure of 30 millimeters transesplenic, but your pressure in the wedge is just about 8. So this is a disease where liver is not that much involved. The involvement is mainly pre-sinusoidal. Then we worked into different parts, pressure between the outflow and the liver. So between the wedge pressure and the intrahepatic pressure, gradient of 6 millimeter. Second, between the spleen and the liver, the gradient was of 9 millimeters. So there were two gradients. Then we said, let's look at the pathology. So we found and tried to find a simple thing, not much money, is the site of obstruction. And since the gradients were so high, we thought lesion has to be cross. So this is the way it is normally, portal vein, artery, and you make a sinusoid, and then you have a hepatic vein. But in patients who have non-cirrhotic, there is a increased resistance due to pre-sinusoidal and a peri-sinusoidal disease. Look at the pathology. The veins, portal veins, are thickened, hardened, and also in the liver parenchyma, in the portal tract, there is also a lesion which is known as obliterative portovenopathy. What I want to stress is, if you have a good question and you dig deep and deep, you can actually find a solution. Today, the liver landscape is the most important, because liver and gut is what drives. All is in the poop. Microbiome establishes immune zonation in the liver. When you are a child, you have a different microbiome. You have to regenerate your liver. You have to grow. Immune zonation in different parts of the liver, zone 1, zone 2, zone 3 is different. As you grow, you have to protect your liver. So the microbiome of the gut has an influence in the immune zonation. Isn't it exciting? Pick it up. Yamanaka is very well known as a Nobel laureate, as a cell biologist. Was he a cell biologist? No, he's an orthopedic guy. And he worked to develop induced pluripotent stem cells, the Yamanaka factors. Can't you do it? Well, what we need is a basic and clinical combination. Break the barriers. I'll come to motivation, and motivation is very important. Most people say, oh, will I get promoted if I publish 2 more papers? Of course. Impact on practice? Of course. You have answered a question. Will it satisfy you? Of course. You have answered something in Nature. Time and money may be optional. Self-realization, I can do it. Leadership, yes, I'm a good teacher, I'm a good researcher. Analytical medicine and academic appetite is filled. So I think what is more important is your motivation, because you would become different. The great republic of medicine knows and has known no national boundaries. You think we can do, and we can. And novel medical research is possible anywhere. So I'll just summarize my takeaway message for you, friends, colleagues, that balancing novelty with feasibility in research is possible. Of course, there is no substitute for money. We need money for high-level throughput science. We do need an enabling environment. Today, that is possible. You can have e-classes, e-learning skills, all developed. And if you have good mentors, which you can get from anywhere in the world, why not collect today? It is a change environment. Remember, mind is above all. The computational guys could become biologists, and biologists could become computational guy to give you the human genome. Remember, if you are good, your offsprings, means your students, your colleagues, can be better, and they will run faster than you. I think the timing for hybrid is hot. What is a hybrid? Who is a hybrid? Hybrid is a guy who can do more than one thing. You can be a researcher, you can be an investigator, and of course a good clinician. And I think productive research career starts in 2021. I know before me the worthy editors of Lancet and others have spoken. I, as my humble clinician, would say that pick up 2021 as the time, a turning point in the tide of life. And while the tide is high, start, make a difference, and then say, yes, we have got more grants and publications because of our unique questions. Thank you all for your kind attention.